are going to get started. My name is Andrew Prevost, and I'm an assistant professor here in the theology department, and one of the folks who's been organizing this event. And we're extremely delighted that you're here today, and we hope that you feel welcome to participate in the conversation. Before we begin, I'd like to introduce the Dean of the Morrissey College of Arts and Sciences, Gregory Kalscher, who would like to say just a couple of words of welcome.
Thanks very much, Andrew. I do just want to welcome everyone here tonight to this important conversation. When Andrew asked me some time ago if I would be available to be here tonight, I was intrigued by the title of the event, Anti-Blackness and Christian Ethics. Anti-blackness was not a term that I had really heard before. I've heard of racism, I've heard of various kinds of injustice, but anti-blackness was something that I was struck by. And I think it's an important moment for us really to reflect on how our aspirations as a Christian community can help to build a society of justice, a society in which the dignity of all is recognized, a society in which we don't have anti-this or anti-that. Our hope at Boston College, I think, as a Jesuit school, is that we can contribute to a greater dialogue between the gospel and the wider society and the wider culture. And we've been living through a period in our own society, I think, where we've seen great need for the resources of the gospel to be brought into more effective dialogue with a range of issues and events that need attention, that need to be addressed. And I think we know that that conversation has to be one that looks to the church itself and looks to the way in which the resources of Christian ethics can address issues in the wider society. So I think this is an important conversation for us to be having. I'm delighted that we can have it here at Boston College, and I'm grateful to Andrew for organizing this event. I look forward to learning from the conversation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And now it is my distinct privilege and honor to introduce our panelists. We have three wonderful, really truly exceptional speakers here for you tonight. So first, starting actually in the middle, I'm going to begin with Professor Kelly Brown Douglas. Kelly Brown Douglas is the Susan B. Morgan Professor of Religion at Goucher College, where she has held the Elizabeth Connolly Todd Distinguished Professorship. She was recently awarded the Goucher College Caroline Doubler Bruckerl Award for Outstanding Faculty Achievement. Prior to coming to Goucher College, she was Associate Professor of Theology at Howard University School of Divinity and Assistant Professor of Religion at Edward Waters College. A leading voice in the development of a womanist theology, Essence Magazine counts Dr. Brown Douglas, quote, among this country's most distinguished religious thinkers, teachers, ministers, and counselors, end quote. She has published numerous essays and articles in national publications, and her books include The Black Christ, Sexuality in the Black Church, What's Faith Got to Do with It, Black Bodies / Christian Soul, Black Bodies and the Black Church, A Blue Slant, and recently Stand Your Ground, Black Bodies and the Justice of God, which offers a powerful theological meditation on the killing of Trayvon Martin and the context surrounding that. Dr. Brown Douglas is a priest in the Episcopal Church and currently canon theologian at Washington National Cathedral. And we're delighted to have her here. On the far end of the panel from me, we have Bryan Massingale. Bryan Massingale is a holder of a doctorate in moral theology and moreover is one of the world's leading Catholic social ethicists and scholars of African American theological ethics, racial justice, and liberation theology. He has just recently joined the theology faculty at Fordham University after spending many years teaching and researching at Marquette University in Milwaukee, where in 2009 he received that institution's highest award for excellence in teaching. He has served as president of the Catholic Theological Society of America and convener of the Black Catholic Theological Symposium, and has received two honorary doctorates. He has written over 80 articles, book chapters, and book reviews for publications including Theological Studies, New Theology Review, Journal of the Society of Christian Ethics, Philosophy and Theology, Journal of Religion and Society, The National Catholic Reporter, and Catholic Peace Voice. His book, Racial Justice and the Catholic Church, from Orbis in 2010, won a first place book award from the Catholic Press Association. Father Massingale is also a Catholic priest of the Archdiocese of Milwaukee. Please help me welcome. Now, closest to me, we have Ashon Crawley. Ashon Crawley is assistant professor of ethnic studies at University of California, Riverside. His research and teaching experiences are in the areas of Black studies, performance theory, and sound studies, philosophy and theology, Black feminist and queer theories. His first book, Black Pentecostal Breath, The Aesthetics of Possibility, is an investigation of aesthetics and performance as modes of alternative social imagining within the Black Pentecostal tradition. It is set to appear virtually any day now from Fordham University Press. And in fact, I think you have a copy of it already.
I have a copy, but not here.
So it will be available very soon to all of you.
Go get it.
he holds a PhD and Master of Arts in English from Duke University, as well as a Master of Theological Studies from the Candler School of Theology at Emory University. Articles of his have appeared in distinguished journals such as the Journal of Theology and Sexuality, Current Musicology, Black Theology, and Souls, a critical journal of Black politics, culture, and society. Now, finally tonight, I'd like to introduce the person who has helped me organize this event and who also will be moderating our panel discussion. And that is Vincent Loy. Vincent will stand up. He's sitting here in the front row. You'll see him soon. Vincent Lloyd is Associate Professor of Theology and Religious Studies at Villanova University. He is the author of many books, including Law and Transcendence, The Problem with Grace, and Black Natural Law. He has published articles in numerous journals such as Black Theology, Theology Today, New Black Friars, Literature and Theology, The Heythrop Journal, Philosophia Africana, the Journal of Religious Ethics, and many more. He currently serves as co-editor of the journal Political Theology and has become a leading international voice on questions of race and secularity. Vincent Lloyd's current research, funded by the American Council of Learned Societies, explores religion, justice, and mass incarceration. Vincent Lloyd and I will be co-editing a volume called Anti-Blackness and Christian Ethics. You're familiar with this a pairing of terms by now, which will be published by Orbis Books sometime next year. Many of the other contributors to that volume are here with us tonight, including the three panelists to my right, as well as others whose names I would like to mention so you know who they are. And those of you who are panelists, contributors to the volume, I want to invite you in a special way to add your voices to our discussion. So the folks I'm thinking of here are M. Sean Copeland, Katie Grimes, Santiago Slavosky, Elias Ortega Aponte, Stephen Batten, and Ebony Marshall Terman. So all of them will be contributing chapters to this book. So those are the introductions. I just want to welcome you once again and say that I hope this is a fruitful conversation for you, and please don't hesitate to share your thoughts and questions in the Q&A. With that, I'll turn it over to my colleague Vincent Lloyd.
I'll just add my welcome to Andrew's and a special thanks to Andrew Frivo for bringing us all here together. It's such a privilege to be here with a dozen of the leading scholars of race and religion to have an intensive day tomorrow working through our essays for this book. Often when one works on a book, it's all abstract over email or so on, but to have the chance to talk in person is really exciting. And thanks to Andrew and to Boston College and to the tiny contribution that Villanova made as well to bringing us all here. What we were envisioning for this evening was largely a conversation about religion, religious ideas, and anti-racist organizing. To be kicked off by the three speakers here, but very much to involve you all. And I'll just ask a couple of questions to get the conversation going. So first, I'd just like to invite each of the three panelists here to reflect for a few minutes on the way that your own scholarship speaks to the anti-racist organizing that we're seeing flourish these last few years.
Hello. First, I'd like to say thank you for the invitation. It's really nice to be here. And I wrote down remarks because I am terrible with sort of thinking off the top of my head. I'll be speaking for like 20 minutes and I'm sweating. And I'm gonna be sad if I do that. So I'm gonna read three things. One, August 8th, 2016, the Gospel Coalition website published a blog post titled, quote, "When God Sends Your White Daughter a Black Husband," end quote, written by a woman, Gay Clark. The piece began, quote, "For years I prayed for a young man I had yet to meet, my daughter's husband. I asked the Lord to make him godly, kind, a great dad, a good provider. I was proud of a wish list void of unrealistic expectations. After all, I knew not to ask for a college football quarterback who loved puppies, majored in nuclear rocket science, and wanted to take his expertise to the mission field. I was an open-minded mom, but God called my bluff. This white, 53-year-old mother hadn't counted on God sending an African-American with dreads named Glenn." She continued, quote, "It wasn't long ago that interracial marriage, particularly a black man like Glenn marrying a white girl like Anna, was considered the ultimate taboo in American white society. Though I have never shared this prejudice, I never expected the issue to enter my life," end quote. The entire piece, for me at least, was cringeworthy. There was lots said on social media, particularly on Twitter, a website that I frequent, that had lots of commentary, jokes, memes, and criticisms of the writing, and the theological, philosophical thrust undergirding Clark's desires, both before and after she met Glenn. After a brief description of her daughter's love for Glenn, Clark gives 8 suggestions for white parents that do not expect for their daughters to engage in interracial relationships and marriage. The first of such suggestions was to, quote, "remember your theology." And when explained, Clark said that to remember theology is to remember that in creation we are all descendants of Adam and Eve. What this meant in practical terms for her was, quote, "Glenn moved from being a black man to a beloved son when I saw his true identity as an image bearer of God, a brother in Christ, and a fellow heir to God's promises," end quote. This movement from black man to beloved son is not a little bit problematic. For Clark to see Glenn's worth and value, his blackness had to be erased, had to be liquidated, and had to be transformed into an acceptable modality through which love from her could occur. His true identity was not his blackness, but his commitment to Christ. This is what bell hooks would describe as white supremacist capitalist patriarchy. It is an ordering of the flesh through racialization. It was not Clark's daughter that needed to move from white woman to beloved daughter. It is the racialized other. As if whiteness itself is not also racialization, the racialization of the modern world. This desire to move from black man to beloved son, and for that to be the true identity of the black, is supersessionist logic. But supersessionism is a core value of modern problems of racialization, the creation and maintenance of purity through whiteness, and the vulgarization of bodies through blackness. The only zone where this move could be effectuated, however, is not the material world, but the spiritual, invisible, intangible one. So police brutality, systemic and structural inequity, anti-black racism are then the problems of the individual not living into the cause of Christ rightly. They are not allowing their lives to move from being black to being beloveds. Of note to me is the way that the white parents should be surprised, and that they are the ones that have to change their thinking in order to be accepted. And not because changing one's thinking and behavior isn't a good thing, but because with Clark's framing, what she calls on white parents to do is to allow black people entry into the fold of Christianity. So whiteness is the thing that sort of contains Christianity. But this entry is conditioned upon the movement from blackness to beloved, from racialized problem to true identification in Christ. I don't want to pick on Gay Clark. I'm sure she has had the best of intentions. But as Imani Perry offers, we are in a moment of post-intentional racism. And so Clark's intentions ultimately are of no concern. Rather, I want to offer that this short blog post is an example of a much longer history of the figuration of blackness as completely non-convergent with Christianity in Western civilization, because Christianity in the West is fundamentally about articulating whiteness or a relation to whiteness, such that for non-whites to become Christian is to trade out their racialization. Christians often presume that salvation, life in Christ, takes away racial distinction. We can look at Paul asserting that there is neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, but all are one in Christ. My research is primarily in Black Pentecostalism, and Gay Clark's expectation that white parents should do what white parents should do in the case of possible interracial marriage is not disconnected from the early 20th century Pentecostal movement's figuration of race and racism and its relation to salvation. I'm thinking of one particular figure in the history of 20th century Pentecostalism, a white man named Frank Bartleman, who said that the color line had been washed away in the blood of the Lamb when people began to speak in tongues at the Azusa Street Revival. The line that was popularized but not created by W.E.B. Du Bois, the color line, according to Bartleman, was no longer a problem because of the performance of flesh at the Azusa Street Revival. But this, of course, was never the case. Members of the Ku Klux Klan began pressuring white congregants of the Azusa Revival, causing what would eventually be the split from several organizations. For one example, the Church of God in Christ, which is a predominantly black Pentecostal organization, from that organization emerged the Assemblies of God, which is a white Pentecostal organization, and they emerged precisely because they called it a doctrinal issue, but the real issue was race, right? There is a misapplication of modern racialization, then, to ancient texts in order to enact a post-racial fantasy, a fantasy that leaves intact the hierarchical inequities in the service of Christian whiteness. In Bartleman's case, it is important to note that black people of the early 20th century Pentecostal movement simply did not see the color line as inconsequential because of speaking in tongues, and that they detected racialization was occurring even on the wooden floors during the revival. William Seymour, the black man who was the founder of the Azusa Street Mission, where the revival took place, eventually disallowed white leadership at the revival because he noticed the white leadership constantly taking over and telling everyone what they should be doing and no longer than letting the black folks or the women actually be in charge. And so he said, y'all can't do this anymore. And so the idea that the color line had been washed away in the blood of the Lamb is actually what allows for the proliferation of anti-black racism in this black Pentecostal movement. Two, Mary. In black Pentecostalism, it is rare to talk about Mary. In other traditions, she is much more fleshed out, so to speak. But from within black Pentecostalism, she is often described as, quote, a poor, unknown, uneducated Palestinian woman, end quote, and that God's choice for her to be the Theotokos, to carry the Logos, to carry the Word, to hold the child in the womb through gestation is praiseworthy. Isn't it great, they say, that God used this poor, unknown, uneducated woman, that God used this Palestinian woman who had no renown, who was not royalty, to bring forth Jesus. It is said that through God, Mary transcends the categorization of social victimization, that she transcends the categorization of degradation, that she transcends the categorization of stigmatization because of the sovereignty of the deity. And this began to bother me very deeply. because what is assumed about Mary is what we assume Mary must have believed about herself in order to glory in the fact of her being chosen. Such declarations have to assume the valuelessness of the person in question as the grounds from which to make assertions about the choices of deities. In other words, we have to believe that Mary believed her station in life was valueless, that she was without virtue and honor, in order for the narratives we tell about her to make sense, in order for the theology and philosophy of Mary as chosen to cohere. We do not think with Mary, but our thinking is supersessionist. It supersedes the very possibility for Mary to think herself as value, without being chosen, without being harnessed and used as the anchoring point for theological and philosophical projects. None of the markers ascribed to Mary in the normative narrative of Black Pentecostalism in and of themselves are markers of valuelessness. It cannot be assumed, in other words, that Mary internalized the inequity of political economy as a personal and moral failure, such that only after such an internalization could she glory in the fact of her being chosen. And this is key for me, because I think this is so precisely because I keep thinking about the way blackness is narrativized in various modes, from the juridical to the medical, from the popular culture to the interpersonal. It is what I think of as a kind of paternalistic benevolence, a narrativizing that occurs from the position of the ones that have othered others in order to declare the relative value or valuelessness of the said others. This is what Gay Clark performs in her writing, implying that Glenn could not be valued or think himself of worth until his transformation from black man to beloved and finding his true identity in Christ. Blackness in Western theological philosophical discourse is the antithesis of the holy, the sacred, the set apart, and the hollow. Blackness is narrativized as the bestial, as the burden, as the problem for purity. Blackness is the wretched, the worm, the worrisome station. But this from the position that assumed, that attempted to grasp and to hold, to harness and abuse black flesh. This from the position, in other words, of whiteness. Black performance, however, illustrates the ways that such narrativity is always in the service of propping up white supremacist capitalist patriarchy, not its undoing. And we see this with sharp intensity and focus when we pay attention to the protests of Black Lives Matter, with the demand for abolition from police, from the carceral state, and the end of the prison industrial complex. We detect this refusal of narrativity with the solidarity work between indigenous peoples and black people, or Palestinian people and black people. And we detect this in the protests of people like Colin Kaepernick. The stories told about us, in other words, we do not have to internalize. And the ways that we inhabit the world are often against such narratives. The refused narrativity, the refusal to accept the narrative of whiteness, of white supremacist capitalist patriarchy, the refusal to assent to anti-black racism and its contents is what I think of as a non-ethical or as an unethical project in part three, and I'm done. Brisha Meadows' father, Jonathan, was abusive to her mother, Brandy. He was verbally and physically abusive to Brandy and emotionally and psychologically manipulative to the entire family. Jonathan was abusive to the children as well, psychologically and emotionally. They existed under the rule of threat and terrorism, and Brisha sought relief from the constant barrage of violence and violation of the home, and so she decided to kill her father. Brisha was arrested for murder, though there are calls from social justice activists for her release. Brandy Meadows, Brisha's mother, calls her a hero, giving her and her family the space to breathe again with ease and comfort. Theorist Jerome Colloway says the following quote: "Instead of criminal charges, what Brisha Meadows needs now desperately, as opposed to incarceration, is a productive psychological counseling and treatment for severe post-traumatic stress disorder," end quote. But how can one come to such a conclusion? I think it is because of what Brisha's actions did is obliterate the question of the ethical in the ways that are consistent with how blackness exists as a critique of the terrain of the ethical or of ethical being. Frederick Douglass is famous to have delivered the speech, "What to the Slave is the 4th of July." What Douglass was interrogating was the ethical terrain upon which celebration of warfare and liberation emerges, since the emergence of such celebration of warfare was produced through the violent exclusion of black people. Another way to ask the question of Douglass is to ask, What to the target of anti-black racism is ethical responsibility? Or what to the target of gender, racialized, class, sex violence and violation is ethics itself? To appraise breaches behaviors through the normative rules and regulations of the juridical is to assume a normative ethics. But what I detect in breaches, what I detect that Breisha enacted was the critique of ethics. She enacted a non-ethics and an ethical performance. And I consider anti-blackness and Christian ethics through a similar thinking, through a similar kind of analytics that asks first, what is the relation of blackness to ethics, and what is the relation of blackness to Christianity, such that we can have something along the lines of an ethics, a black Christian ethics that responds to and anticipates anti-black racism. Finally, in the filmic version of The Color Purple, Seeley says, quote, "I'm poor, black, I may even be ugly, but dear God, I'm here," end quote. And with that, she rode off with friends into the sunset and away from the man that abused her. Seeley did not need to be chosen or shown favor because at that instant, she refused to internalize what the world had said about her capacity for life. It was her declaration of being here, which is to say existing and breathing, that was the radical performance. Her being here is what distressed Albert. It's what distressed and disturbed him because he spent so much time and energy wanting to disallow the possibility for such a declaration. So to riff on my friend Fred Moten, the consent to being shamed she could not resist, she could still, importantly, withhold. Withhold, withheld as in breath, as in the possibility for existence, as in life. Thank you.
Thank you. My remarks aren't quite as prepared and as thoughtful as yours, Ashon, and I thank you for that. But they follow, I believe, in the sense that Ashon talked to us about the anti-black nature of Christianity and Christian identity. I think I want to take just a brief time to talk about the anti-black nature of American identity and of America itself. And as a theologian, I follow in the line of many, but I take seriously Karl Barth's, oddly enough, and I'm talking about anti-blackness, but I take seriously Karl Barth's observation that to be a theologian, you must have the Bible in one hand and the newspaper in the other. And so that it is constantly a dialogue between the Bible, if you will, and a newspaper, and recognizing the fact that God acts and God is consistently acting in our world in a particular way. And so as a theologian, one always has to ask, where is God? How is God acting? What is God calling us to do? And so trying to discern in as much as we can in the imperfect ways in which we can, always at any given moment in time, trying to discern the very movement of God. And so for me, it's about trying in this moment of time, trying to discern the very movement of God. And so, as I say that as the sort of prolegomena, so I'm going to take a few minutes indeed to talk about this matter of anti-blackness in the current context in which we do find ourselves. And for me, that is a context in which Black Lives Matter is contested not so much with the response of All Lives Matter, or even with the response that Blue Lives Matter. But the true contesting narrative, it seems to me, to Black Lives Matter, which these other two, All Lives Matter and Blue Lives Matter, are really the sub-narrative of the grand narrative that truly contests Black Lives Matter. And that mantra of contesting is Make America Great Again. And so that's as a language in the world.
Yeah.
But indeed, it is the case, along with the fact that the protest of Colin Kaepernick would be met with the kind of vitriol that suggests that he is anti-American and that protest is anti-patriotic or is non-patriotic. Those are the contrasting narratives to Black Lives Matter. And so I want to say something about that. That these two narratives, that is, Make America Great Again and that Colin Kaepernick is non-patriotic, that they are contesting narratives in relationship to Black Lives Matter tells us something, it seems to me, about America's very identity. This is an identity, make no mistake about it, that is very much grounded in a narrative of Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism. Those Puritans and pilgrims who came to this country, as well as the founding fathers, no one more Anglo-Saxonist than Thomas Jefferson himself, the father of democracy, quote unquote, all believed that they were indeed carrying forth the vision, the exceptionalism of those Anglo-Saxons that a early Greek philosopher identified who lived in the ancient woods of Germany. They were all shaped by the Anglo-Saxon myth that says that these ancient German Anglo-Saxons were exceptionally virtuous, exceptionally moral, and had an exceptional love for freedom. And so it was that as the Pilgrims and the Puritans crossed the Atlantic running from the England, they believed themselves to in fact be the remnant, if you will, of those Anglo-Saxons in the ancient woods of Germany. And they believed that they were coming with a divine imprimatur, if you will, because they believed themselves to be chosen, chosen by God to indeed create what we all are very familiar with in America's lore, that city on the hill. Thomas Jefferson was likewise shaped by the Anglo-Saxon myth. Thomas Jefferson likewise believed that America indeed needed to be, ought to be, if indeed it was going to be a city on the hill, that it ought to be a model of Anglo-Saxon governance, of Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism. By the way, so did Ben Franklin. He was so worried that Philadelphia was going to be overrun with immigrants that weren't Anglo-Saxon. Which brings me to this matter. And that is that, informed with this grand narrative of Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism, we see that this narrative will indeed naturally, inexorably, it is compelled to begin to lift up, begin to cherish whiteness. Why is this the case? I like the way James Baldwin puts it as we think of its emergence, the emergence of whiteness. He says, James Baldwin says something like this. He says that a funny thing happened on the way to Ellis Island. He says they came from all over Europe, they did. He said they were Italian, he said they were German, he said they were Irish, he said they were French. But when they got across the ocean and got to Ellis Island, they all became white. Whiteness becomes the mask of protection, as well as the thing that mystifies, if you will, the notion that not everyone in America, not every immigrant from Europe, was indeed Anglo-Saxon. However, if you were white, you were Anglo-Saxon enough. For indeed, whiteness allowed for one to mystify the very notion or the illusion, to uphold, I should say, the illusion of America's Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism. And it at least prevented anyone that absolutely was not Anglo-Saxon from getting on the other side of whiteness into that exceptional space. Because it became the case that if you were white, at least it was thought that you could indeed take on, become acculturated, become socialized into Anglo-Saxon ways. And so whiteness meant that by adoption, whether or not you were Anglo-Saxon by birth, at least if you were white, you could be an adopted Anglo-Saxon. Now this is at the heart of America's identity. American exceptionalism is nothing less than Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism. Whiteness emerged to protect that identity. That means this, that whiteness consistently stands its ground against anything that would corrupt in any way the identity or the fact of America's Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism. I won't go into the details. It's the trajectory of history tells us that, and maybe in conversation we can say something more about that. But here's my point for today. It is then no surprise. It should be no surprise at all that there is one in our midst who speaks loudly of making America great again. This is a proportional response, if you will, to a black man in the White House. It is indeed the case that any time black people have in any way, shape, or form began to move toward freedom and began to encroach upon, it's believed to encroach upon, but began to enjoy some of the rights that were carved out for those who are white, any time that has happened, whiteness has stood its ground, be it the response after emancipation and post-Reconstruction, or be it the response after the Civil Rights Movement. It is no accident that the same language that we heard emerging after the Civil Rights Movement from a presidential candidate, law and order, we have heard emerge again. This is nothing less than America's Anglo-Saxonist exceptionalist identity rearing its head and whiteness standing its ground to protect it. It is no accident that in this day, when those who are non-white are vastly becoming the majority in America, that you would hear the rhetoric of make America great again. I don't need to tell you what that really means. What this means, therefore, is that America's very identity has at its roots, is an oppositional identity. It defines itself in opposition to all that is non-white. Toni Morrison said it well. She said, endemic to America, anytime we say America, implied is the other. that is those of whom America opposes. Whiteness is an oppositional construct. Whiteness only makes sense in relationship to that which is non-white. White culture is an oppositional culture. And by the way, not everybody that happens to look like a white American has to act like a white American. And so that's why I talk about white culture, because just because you look like a white American doesn't mean that you have to live into white culture and act like a white American. So, response again to Colin Kaepernick's protests. Of course, it would be seen as non-American and non-patriotic, because he is lifting up the fact that non-white lives matter. Of course, the Black Lives Matter movement would be seen as anti-American in some way. Because it is, if we understand that at America's very root is the fact that that is that which protects whiteness. So, what are we gonna do about this? What kind of response, what kind of theological response can we make to this? I'm just gonna suggest a few things. I'm gonna sort of throw some things out there and make a case and argument that perhaps we can talk about later. But some of the things that we have to address that we're gonna do something about it, and that I think theologically we must address. And I began this with the frame of trying to understand, of course, where God is, who God is in all of this, which means really trying to discern the very justice of God and what that looks like. Let me begin by saying this, and begin where I'm gonna end, that I truly do believe, and you've probably heard this in other ways before other people say it, but I truly believe that we are living and what we can call theologically, of course, a Kairos moment. Or Kairos. Kairos. That time so pregnant with the presence of God. Yet Kairos is that time in which chaos ensues, right? It's a time of chaos, but chaos always presents us with opportunity. It's a time where God is disrupting things as they are, so that we can indeed begin to live into a new reality. Now, we can miss the Kairos. Mm-hmm. And folks like Paul Tillich and what said, and he missed the Kairos even when he could see people from missing Kairos. But Tillich and others talked about from time to time, we've missed the Kairos. We can miss it. But make no mistake about it, this is a Kairos. And so the first question we might ask is, where will we find God? We find God in those places where people are disrupting things the way they are. That's where we find God. Where people are disrupting these systems and structures that indeed dehumanize, demean, and degrade other lives. Now, then one would say, huh, but indeed, how can we say that when we look around and we see some of the violence that has ensued? Another point to put your hat on. We need to really begin to rethink what we mean by violence. And justice. And peace. God's peace is not the opposite of God's, God's peace is not equivalent to nonviolence. God's peace is equivalent to justice. Injustice of any kind is violent. The kind of violence that one sees spilling out on the streets is the violence that violence created. America's very identity compels violence. It is violent. Why? because it has indeed led to, and it has upheld, and it has produced, nurtured, and fostered systems and structures that indeed deny, make hard, denigrate the lives of others. We're talking about inequitable schooling. We're talking about inequitable living conditions. We're talking about lack of access to jobs. We're talking about lack of access to recreation, for that matter. We're talking about poverty. The answer to poverty is not wealth, it's justice. Violence is a water supply system full of lead. Violence is a school system where two-thirds of the high schools that are predominantly Latino and Black don't offer algebra 2. And a third of those don't offer chemistry. That's violence. And so what we see are violence, are neighborhoods in which people don't simply have the necessities to survive, not just survive, but to survive with dignity. The dignity of who they are as sacred creatures of God. And so, we've got to rethink what we mean when we talk about violence. And if we want to stop the violence, we've got to stop the injustice. And the answer to that is God's justice. This thing, no justice, no peace, that's right. No justice, no peace, because peace is justice. Anything less is cheap grace. And so, that is why I say that if we ask, where is God? God is in those places where we are disrupting things as they are, so that we can indeed create a world that is supposed to be. And that looks like a world of God's time, of God's peace, of God's kingdom, with the caution of sounding patriarchal. And so, and I will just end by saying this, and I hope this allows us for more conversation. Find God in the face of the Trayvons, the Michaels, the Sandras, the Rakias, the Renishas, the Tamirs. Lord, where did we see you? On a street corner, being choked. On the sidewalk, being shot. In a park, being killed. That's where we find and see God. And then in the narrative of the resurrection, we see God in those moms who are fighting to make sure that the crucified deaths of their children do not define their children's lives. And so we find God in those resurrecting moments that overcome the crucifixion of this world that are indeed unjust and thus anti-Black. And I'll just end there. Thank you.
For their very rich and provocative contributions. And what I want to do is answer the question of what does my research agenda contribute to reflect the present moment by putting their remarks in a Catholic context, being the black Catholic up here at a Catholic Jesuit institution. To understand that contribution, I want to tell some stories that give flesh to the idea of blackness as the antithesis of the holy and Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism. What does that mean in a Catholic context? About 10 years ago, I was working with the Catholic bishops of the United States on a proposed letter on the sin of racism. That pastoral letter went through 5 different drafts. As we gathered to discuss the final draft, 2 of the bishops present offered comments. One said, "You talk about white privilege in this document, but my people won't understand white privilege." Another at the table opined, "If we say what you want us to say, my people will get mad at me." After I heard this, I said, "Thank you, Your Excellencies, for your comments. They are more helpful than you realize." "But I have a question for you. When you say that your people won't understand or your people will get mad, whom do you mean? Who are your people?" And there was silence in the room because they had inadvertently revealed Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism. They had inadvertently revealed who their people are, who are truly Catholic. Second story about blackness being the antithesis of the holy. Recall that when Pope Benedict visited the United States, he offered a mass at RFK Stadium in Washington, D.C. It was a mass that was supposed to celebrate the rich cultural diversity of the Catholic Church. And so the first reading was that classic account from the Acts of the Apostles, so the Holy Spirit descending upon the peoples of the world, and they all heard the divine revelation. And the prayer of the faithful was in a variety of languages, and the offertory gifts were presented with accompanied by spirited gospel singing and in Latino choir. Afterwards, on the quasi-official cable network, EWTN, the commentator remarked, quote, "We have just been subjected to an over-preening display of multicultural chatter. And now the Holy Father will begin the sacred part of the Mass." Note the opposition between multicultural and sacred. So when we hear words such as blackness as the antithesis of the holy and Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism, these are not abstract concepts. These have real flesh and blood, and they are especially important for us to understand what is the Catholic response to the Black Lives Matter movement. And as I have argued, and I will say it this way, the Catholic response to the Black Lives Matter movement can be summarized this way. The Catholic Church will deal with the Black Lives Matter movement only insofar as it does not make white people uncomfortable. In other words, white comfort is going to set this pace, the stage, and the manner of Catholic response to the Black Lives Matter movement. Because the Catholic Church is characterized by a normative whiteness.
Now, let me kind of flesh that out a little bit. This is not a new concept in the Catholic Church. Back in 1968, at the dawn of the modern Black Catholic movement, the Black Catholic clergy met for the first time independently, and in April of 1968, they issued a document, a manifesto, in which they described the Catholic Church as being a white racist institution. Not to be undone, the Black Sisters met in August of 1968 and basically said what we said, but they said it, you know, a lot more provocatively, because after all, the Sisters will do that, okay? But what does it mean to be a white racist institution? As I said in my book on racial justice, what makes the Catholic Church white and racist is the pervasive belief that European aesthetics, music, theology, and persons, and only these, are standard, normative, universal, and truly Catholic. Everything else is Catholic by exception, Catholic with an asterisk. That is what it means to be truly Catholic, this normative whiteness. And so that means that the Catholic Church will engage the challenge of the present moment only insofar as it does not make white people uncomfortable. They might be saying, oh my God, this is really sad. Well, it is sad. But don't just take my word for it. Let's look at a couple of examples of how Catholic bishops have, in fact, dealt with the current moment that's in front of us. Recall, in April of last year, the death of Freddie Gray in Baltimore. One of the many names we could call out. In the aftermath of that, the Catholic Archbishop of Baltimore issued a statement on the day of the funeral of Freddie Gray. And among the many things he said, quote, "May we unite in prayer for an immediate and lasting healing, a healing brought about by dialogue, mutual respect, and understanding. We pray that following today's funeral and in the days to come, protesters will voice their views freely and openly, but without violence, which only deepens and prolongs injustice." Note the subtle, who's to blame for this? And if that weren't enough, he continues, "And finally pray together that God will grace us always with his presence so that our broken city can once again be whole and our minds and our hearts will be open to peace and love." The problem, though, for many of the protesters is that the city was never whole to begin with. And this is not something that's a figment of African-American imagination. As we found out this summer after the Department of Justice reviewed the Baltimore Police Department and issued a scathing denunciation of long-standing abuses. But the Catholic Church can only deal with this by saying, we want to once again be whole, but we were never whole to begin with. Or again, in June of 2015, as the bishops gathered in St. Louis, the diocese in which Ferguson is situated. And Ferguson was not on their agenda. Baltimore was not on their agenda. When Black Catholic bishops intervened and said, you can't gather in Ferguson and not talk about these events, the response was, well, it's in our five-year plan that we will eventually deal with the sin of racism. And they said, you cannot do that. So then the bishop took it upon himself, the president, to say, issued the statement, calling upon Catholics to do many things, to pray for peace and healing, to study the Word of God, to make a sincere effort to encounter other races, and then encouraging people to get to know your law enforcement officers and encourage young people to respect all legitimate authority. As if what got Tamir Rice, a 12-year-old kid killed in a park,
disrespect for legitimate authority. But let's back up and ask why. The normative whiteness does explain this, that you can only deal with these issues insofar as they do not disrupt that whiteness. Which means that the Catholic Church, when it deals with these issues, deals with them from what I call a race relations paradigm. In other words, it's assumed that what we really do is this is fundamentally a problem of miseducation, of ignorance, and so what we need to do is have better instruction and dialogue and get to know one another. But a race relations paradigm deliberately camouflages or cannot deal with social conflict. It cannot deal with conflictual social reality. It cannot deal with oppositional reality. That has to be literally whitewashed. A more adequate frame would be a racial justice paradigm. Because dialogue can only go so far. We ultimately need more just, not just forms of relationship, but more just structures. These paradigms, again, are long, the tension between these paradigms is long-standing in the Catholic Church. Because that paradigm came into existence basically in the 1930s in opposition to a group of African-American Catholics who called themselves the Federated Colored Catholics, who were pressing the church in an activist voice, denouncing the segregation present in U.S. society and within the church, and a group of Catholic clergy, among them being a Jesuit named John Lafarge, thought that this was not being deferential enough to the authority of the Catholic Church, the white authority of the Catholic Church, so they instituted a constitutional coup in which they had basically abolished this group, established the Catholic Interracial Council that basically tried to promote better understanding between races through decency, courtesy, and good manners. Now, I'm not against decency, courtesy, and good manners. But that's not the issue. But Lafarge's approach triumphed. And it has set the paradigm for Catholic engagement on issues of race and racism from the beginning. So then we come to this conference on anti-blackness. And I have to say that in all honesty, most Catholics are going to be probably unprepared to hear that kind of language or dialogue. If we can't deal with white privilege, we certainly can't deal with anti-blackness. Because it requires taking the veil off of who we are as Catholics and challenging the normative whiteness, which is constitutive of U.S. Catholicism. So then what are we to do? Where do we find God? I think we need to begin by retrieving an ancient biblical practice of lament. I'm speaking particularly as Catholics, but you believe here in the United States, one of the things we have to do is we have to grieve and mourn our history, to grieve and mourn our current reality. I am struck by and inspired by the reality that in apartheid South Africa, funerals were the one place where you could have a legitimate interracial gathering. Wow. And whether we are on one side of the divide or the other, what we all can do is grieve and mourn. I don't often wake up in the middle of the night crying. But a year ago, November, I woke up in the middle of the night and I was sobbing uncontrollably because I was thinking of Tamir Rice,
A 12-year-old boy sitting on a swing in a park doing what 12-year-old boys do, and 2 seconds after a cop pulls up, he's dead. There's something that's beyond blasphemous about that. And we need to cry and to mourn and to grieve and to let our hearts and souls be ripped open. Because then we will find the internal motivation to say, excuse me, this shit's got to stop.
Amen.
And what makes that theological, because we're going to have the context, is that it's simply an updating of St. Thomas Aquinas, who simply said that injustice moves us because justice moves us because injustice first moves us. Because St. Thomas Aquinas said that we sin against, we commit the sin of anger in 3 ways: by excess, by being wrathful, by, he said we also sin against anger by inappropriate object when we're, you know, for example, we're really mad at somebody, we kick the dog, misdirected object. But he also said we sin by omission when we are not angry when we ought to be, because anger is the passion that moves the will to justice. And so my work, and what I think this present moment calls us to, is a moment of lamentation, a moment of grief. Because then maybe we will be moved to say enough is enough, and to make our world and our church a less and less imperfect witness to God's expansive reign. Thank you.
Thank you so much to the three presenters for those three very powerful and thought-provoking sets of remarks. I think we have about 20 minutes for discussion and questions. I guess there's a microphone.
That's a very good question, thank you. I think it's important to understand that racial injustice can exist even when you have a numerical majority of those. Because I think that, again, let me give you a concrete example of that. Pope Benedict also had a mass in Benin as well. No, not Benin. I think it is Benin. French speaking, it was Benin, right. And one of the things that happened there was that before the mass began, an official looking Monsignor came out and announced to the congregation that because of the reverence due to a papal liturgy, hand clapping and rhythmic movement would be inappropriate for this particular liturgy. In other words, again, a normative European whiteness prevailed even when you've got a congregation of mostly Africans.
Now, I do think that what you're seeing, though, in, for example, outside of official movements, for example, I can speak as a Catholic theological ethicist. One of the things that we're trying to do, we have this international network of Catholic ethicists, and we're making proactive efforts to nurture, support, and increase the number of African Catholic theological ethicists and Asian Catholic theological ethicists, because it's only when we do that that we then create a kind of critical mass that can speak out against this, you know, large movement of normative whiteness. But so can it happen? Yes. But will it, does it happen automatically? I guess that's the thing I want to understand. Automatically, it won't happen simply because you have a demographic change. Because we have right now, as Dr. Douglas said, we have a beginning of that demographic shift taking place in this country, and that's why you have this powerful, palpable unease in this country over that demographic shift, which is fueling the rise of making America great again.
That microphone is coming around.
In terms of possibly cultivating empathy within the Catholic Church, is it, how do you feel, or how do people respond when you bring up the fact that Irish and Italians also face that kind of prejudice? And how does that, does that at all weaken a consciousness amongst the bishops in terms of how they should possibly respond? Or, I guess that's the point.
Two remarks with that. No, it doesn't, because what it does is say, oh, you see, we were oppressed, we had problems, and we did it, so why can't you? Which then goes to the next step, is to interrogate the statement, well, Irish and Italians went through the same things we did, and they didn't. The immigrant experience is not the experience of enslavement. But we don't understand that here in America because we have never dealt with slavery. We have never dealt with it. We have never really understood what African enslavement meant in this country, how it built this country, and how African enslavement did not end in 1865. Part of the problem we have as Americans is that when we talk about African enslavement, we're going to say, oh, but that was so long ago. Get over it. But the thing is, and so we said, well, Abraham Lincoln took care of that problem. But it did not end. Because Jim Crow, legal segregation, was simply the continuation of slavery by another name. And we think that was so long ago, it wasn't. It's so recent in our American history that for many of the Union audience, you are probably among the first generation to be born in a post-Jim Crow era reality. So we need to understand that the immigrant experience is not the same as the enslavement experience. And so appealing to the American, the Irish immigrant experience for the bishops doesn't work. One, because it's a faulty analogy, and because of the faulty analogy, it leads them to say, well, we came here and there were signs and windows, and yet look at us now, well, why can't you do what we did? Well, because we were never in your position.
Say something about that, and obviously I can't speak completely to the Catholic context in particular, but the Catholic context is in a wider context in which, of course, one has to always ask, what does it mean to be church, first of all? And there's a difference between, and then I'll speak directly to this immigrant experience, but there's a difference between being a social institution that happens to be religious and being a church. And so all of our institutions that in our faith communities always have to ask this question, you know, are we church? And so just so when we talk about, whether we're talking about the Catholic church or the Episcopal church of which I'm a part of or any other church, we've got to ask, who are we? Are we reflecting the ways of society or are we reflecting the ways of God? What does it mean to be church? It means to be an embodiment in some way of the ministry of Jesus, an embodiment of the revelation of God. And I don't know. And so not everything that calls itself church is church.
Amen.
And so that's the first thing. And so that we have to understand that the church is called not simply to be priestly or pastoral, but it's called to be prophetic. And so we've got to always hold that, and I could go on, but I just want to hold that. And so, you know, that just because someone says we're the Catholic Church or the Episcopal Church, we got to say, oh, really? So that's the first thing. Churches have to be critiqued and called to themselves to be church. The other thing, and it seems that when you talk about the immigrant experience, you're indeed right. One of, there's a story, and it's in, can't call his name now, but book called The Making of Whiteness. But as I have said before, said earlier in brief, the one thing that the immigrants had going for them was that they were white. And we, so there's a story of an Italian man running down the street, and the old guard, old stock, because there was a difference between the old stock in America when all the immigrants came and the new stock, and the old stock wanted to be protected from the new stock, because the new stock wasn't coming from countries in Europe that were Anglo-Saxon, you know, the dirty Italians and the Irish and all of them. And the Italian's running around down the street, and he's saying, but I'm white, but I'm white. All right? That's what the immigrant has. That they're white. And that's where you see that this Anglo-Saxon exceptionalism and stand your ground culture first stood its ground against these immigrants. Ah, but indeed they were white. And so you began to see the emergence of whiteness, the emergence of white supremacy, the emergence of this whole ideology of sacred whiteness. So that's what they got going for them, and it makes their experience totally different than the non-white body in this country, and particularly the black body, because it stands in such juxtaposition to whiteness. Let me just add this real quickly as well. While we talk about the construction of sacred whiteness, we also have to talk about, which I won't go into in detail here this evening, but we have to talk about as well the construction of anti-blackness. And so that's why one has almost a natural, instinctive reaction to the black body because of the way blackness has been constructed. So to see a Tamir Rice in the park, and studies have been done, police officers, there are numerous studies with police officers, the way that they will react to the black body. There was a study, for instance, that they ran pictures with men with guns or without guns. And if the person was white and had a gun, the officer was less likely to shoot him, didn't see the gun. And was more likely to shoot a black person that they saw without a gun. Because there's this instinctive, embedded within our collective consciousness in America, is this notion of anti-blackness, and we demonize blackness, we vilify blackness, so when we see a black body, we see a dangerous body. So you automatically, Tamir has to be dangerous. He looks 21, not 12, and by the way, I always like to add that even if that gun he had in that park was real, I'm from Ohio, so that Ohio has an open carry law, so he had the right to carry the gun anyway. So no one talks about that. But there's a construction of anti-blackness, and so we always have to keep that in mind. It's not just the sacred sacralizing of whiteness, but it's also the demonizing of blackness. And so that the police officer that killed Michael Brown would say, I saw a demon coming toward me. Guess what? In his mind, he did. And that's the danger. that the blackness, anti-blackness means that black, that gaze, blackness itself, signifies danger, signifies a threat. And that's what we've got to get to in this country.
Some very close, sort of intimate friendships that you lose. But I think it's important, the question is, are we gonna be the church, right? It's not the primary question I ask myself on a daily basis, but if the question is something about how am I living out sort of the path, the life of, that Jesus has established, then it cannot be about appeasing even the people that we love dearly, right? That sometimes we are going to say things and we're going to challenge them on things that make them angry. And I think that it's important because integrity is an important thing. It's more important to say that this is an instance of anti-black racism. This is an instance of anti-indigeneity. This is an instance of homophobia, transphobia. It's more important to say that than to have a relationship with someone where you're afraid to say that, right? Because what is the relationship then if you are constantly living under the fear of actually voicing what you actually really think? And so for me, one of the things that I had to give up or had to release or relinquish was the desire to have people like me and to have people that I love me, right? That there had to be a moment where what is the work of my life? And is my life dedicated to a certain kind of understanding of justice and equity? And if it is, then, you know, the Bible says about, you know, leaving behind family members in order to do the cause of justice, right? And so that's not like an abstract concept. It is very real for a lot of us that have said, I cannot live in a way where you tell me that I should be ashamed of myself, that I should hate other people because of their station in life, that I should hate people because of poverty. That it is more important to me to leave behind the things that are behind me and to reach towards, or like Paul says, press towards something that is higher than yourself. And so I encourage you to find community, because there is community that you can gather around that you can talk to, that will talk to you with these things, that will fortify you for the moments when you have the conversations with the people that you love that are not easy conversations. But you can't ever think it's about you by yourself. You have to do it with other people. And once you find that community, the community then is the one that you rely on to say, hold me up when I go into my parents' house and I say this thing that they're not going to say or that they're not going to like? How can you hold me up? How can you hug me? How can you love me through what are going to be undoubtedly difficult conversations and may possibly be not great results, right? But if the point is to live in the world more justly and not about having relationships that we think are unchangeable, then to live in the world more justly actually compels us to do the very difficult things. And my life isn't the model, but I'm just saying that I have lived in such a way that I understand that struggle where you don't want to actually rock any kinds of boat, and you really, really want, you love your parents, and that's a very real thing. And yet, the question is, what are we called to do in excess of the love of the very relationships that have sort of established us and given us the fortitude to even make the call to say, you know, there's something that we need to talk about?
I think we have time for one last question.
Hi. Bryan, I'm in the process of reading Racial Justice and the Catholic Church, and it's powerful. And I would like you to make a comment or tell this group, in case they haven't read it, about the AP photos after Katrina. Because I think that says volumes more than almost anything else can say.
Hmm. Thank you. What she's referring to is that in the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina, there were two photographs that were taken of people engaged in identical actions in the same social circumstance. One photo had a picture of an African American wading through flood water with a satchel behind him. And the caption read, a man wades through chest deep flood water after looting a store. The photo of two white people also wading through water with a satchel of groceries. And this one said, two people wade through chest deep water in New Orleans after finding bread and soda. Now, neither of the parties paid for anything that they possessed. One was described as looting, the other as finding. Now, there was a storm of protests that erupted over these, and they were taken down, but through the wonders of the internet, nothing is ever lost. Keep that in mind, future employers, check your Facebook pages. But it shows the power of unconscious socialization and the unconscious ways in which we demonize blackness and valorize whiteness. No one sat down and made the deliberate decision saying, oh, they're white, so we're going to say they're finding. Oh, they're black, we're going to say they're looting. They went on automatic pilot because this is how we have been malformed by our society. We take it for granted that this is what is going on, because these are the deep cultural meanings ascribed to white bodies and ascribed to black bodies, so that they no longer become descriptors of bodies, but become descriptors of our souls, our work, our behavior. So just as we presume danger, we presume criminal behavior. But we also then give some the benefit of the doubt. For example, it's always strange to me that when we see a white individual that's guilty of mass shootings, we immediately want to know, well, what was their background like? Were they on drugs? Did they get the mental help that they need? Maybe they were bullied. But those are not the questions that are asked of anyone, of a black person shooting anyone.
We assume they're criminals, we have to lock them up or punish them. One of the ways in which whiteness, the notion of whiteness manifests itself and demonized blackness manifests itself is who gets the benefit of the doubt? Who gets the break?
I just want to point out an example, and again a study that's been done that suggests that 90% of Americans think that it is right to protest. Americans have a right to protest. But then when they put black in front of the protest, less than 50% thought that it was all right for black people to protest. Now, and so that's why you get these reactions to Black Lives Matter, because it's not black people don't protest, they riot. White people protest.
It's true.
And if you want a concrete example, where can you get 50 black men or more holding off the federal government with their guns for how many days was that?
Oh, yeah, right.
And not one white man got shot or killed, isn't it?
I think one did that.
Oh, well, one, but his own volition. Now, no one went in there, and if you got, you have one black person with a toy gun. No, one black person with a gun in Walmart looking at it on display,
that's
and the police
right.
came
right,
out
exactly.
and
right.
shot him.
Right.
And
wow.
Black bodies, this is what he's talking about. This is right, the benefit of the doubt. That the benefit that goes if, to black people, they must be doing something criminal, something wrong, something dangerous. And there can't be black protests. All they can do is riot. But white people can protest even with guns. The black people can't even walk down the street and think about a gun. So we got it right. But this is what's in our collective consciousness, that it's almost automatic, and we don't even question that there's a problem with it because we don't see the problem because it's so embedded into
black
we are. Well, yeah.
And another thing too, just to briefly, an amen to your amen. Well, yeah. There was a hashtag or a movement on Twitter that was called hashtag Criming While White. And it was about white students talking about being involved in criminal behaviors and never having any encounter with law enforcement.
Wow.
And it was basically a way of basically lifting up this valorization. In other words, black people and white people are not treated the same. Black crimes and white crimes are not treated the same. And so you have white people talking about their encounters while criming while white and getting the benefit of the doubt, getting the break, in situations that would never have happened with African Americans. I think it's important for us to talk about this, so when we use phrases like the valorization of whiteness, or the construction of sacred whiteness, or the demoness, or the demonicness of black bodies, those are not abstract concepts. Those are existential realities that we are all aware of if we have the courage to be honest about our reality.
Well, you've given us so much to think about tonight and in coming days and weeks. Please join me in thanking the
thank you all for coming. I need to do a couple of things here before you all leave. Number one is I need to thank our sponsors. So let me offer a heartfelt thanks to the Institute for Liberal Arts, the Theology Department, African and African Diaspora Studies, and Villanova's Department of Theology and Religious Studies. And also, I have a student here who has an important announcement for you, so I'm going to pass the mic over.
I'm not a student.
Not a student. Still an important announcement.
I'm actually a campus minister here, an affiliate campus minister. I just wanted to say thank you so much for being here and having this conversation. It's so important. If you would like to continue this conversation, we actually have a small group that meets every Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, or rather 8 o'clock, eight to nine o'clock in the gate, which is Stayer 104. So if you want to continue this conversation about the intersection of faith and social justice, specifically race and racial reconciliation, then we would love to have you there to talk about things that you talked about. But how do you have these conversations with people about this? And like, what does Jesus think? Why would he say Black Lives Matter? Different things like that. We'll be talking about those things. And so we would love to have you. We're sponsored by an InterVarsity Christian Fellowship, but also supported by Boston College. So we would love to see you there. Thank you so much again.
And safe travels to everyone. Thank you for coming.